Do these skincare innovations actually work? Are they worth it? And are they safe? It's Michelle of Lab Muffin Beauty Science, chemistry PhD and skincare nerd. Today, I'm breaking down some skincare innovations people have been asking me about. I'm covering a cool new light mask, spicules like in the VT Riedel shots, so many of you have asked me about that, and some vitamin C formula updates. Starting with the red light mask, this section is sponsored by Iristore, but these are my honest opinions. Check out this link for more about my sponsorships and how they operate. I've talked about light treatments before, what they do and the science behind how they work, but in short, the main benefits of red and infrared light for skin are smoothing out fine lines and wrinkles, reducing skin sensitivity and redness. I've only been using them for about 4 months and I try a lot of skincare products, so I can't say this is all definitely the red light, but I found that my perioral dermatitis is a lot calmer, my skin tone is more even, and it kind of just gives me a nice glow. Last time I talked about getting a product with the right specs, but home devices do need to be used consistently to see benefits. And what makes a product more usable for one person isn't going to be the same as for someone else, so you want to read lots of opinions from different people. I get sent lots of masks, so I am planning to talk more about the differences between products that are a bit harder to see, and maybe someday I'll have a page that is as useful as Goals to Get Glowing. I was really excited when I heard Iristore were launching a new mask because they have been making hair growth devices for a really long time, and the design is a bit different from most of the ones that you see around. When I was trying out popular flexible silicone masks, those are like the default ones, there were little things I didn't like, not quite deal breakers, but they did make me skip using them, which meant less consistency. This mask solves a lot of them, and it turns out that was the thought process behind this design. This is a hard shell mask with three wavelengths. It's got red and infrared, which are for general anti-aging, plus we have blue for acne. I don't really use the blue that much because at the moment hyperpigmentation is more of a problem than acne. They are all at the best tester wavelengths for skin, and there are three different modes. Power and number of LEDs. I've seen lots of people say that the number of LEDs doesn't matter, but that isn't true. So the power is measured right above each LED, so you can think of the power as like how bright each spot is, and then the number of LEDs is how many of these spots you have spread out over your skin. This has 120 LEDs of each color, which is almost double compared to standard masks like the Omnilux Contour and the Current Body Series 1. They have 66 of each. The power for the anti-aging mode is a little bit higher than for the other common masks, but this does mostly sit off the skin. And this design also has more light escape, so I think overall it ends up in a similar Goldilocks kind of zone based on my experience and the reviews I've seen. And remember, with light, more light is not necessarily better. Iristore have gotten a third-party clinical study done, which is really cool for such a new product, and you can see some before and after photos on their website. In terms of fit, flexible masks and hard masks have been pretty similar for me so far, but if your face is a bit further from average, then you might want to be more careful, especially for hard masks. These are the dimensions, and I'll be doing these photos for all the masks I review. Light coverage is about a centimeter more than standard masks if you go vertically, and around the same if you're going across. I've tried about 6 masks so far, and this has become the mask that I reach for the most because it is really comfortable and it is the most user-friendly for me. Yes, they are the sponsor, but the reason I took this sponsorship is because I genuinely really like this mask and I think it is a great option for a lot of people. Compared to flexible masks, it's easier to get the placement right with a hard mask. This one touches my chin and my cheeks a bit, but nowhere near as much as a flexible mask. I personally don't really mind that high contact with a flexible mask, but I know some people find it really awful. For me, this mask is super comfortable. This is also the best mask I've tried so far for multitasking. I personally need to multitask when I'm doing red light treatments. I cannot just sit there. This is the same weight as the flexible mask, but it feels lighter because I think it doesn't flop around and it doesn't squish my head in as much. The controller is the best one I've tried so far. It has a belt clip. It also shows you how many minutes you have left, and you can also pause your treatment. You can also see the charging progress. The inbuilt eye shield in this is really good at blocking out light. This is a bit more important for blue light, even though the level is generally safe. Some people with specific eye conditions can have problems. Red and infrared though seem to be mostly beneficial for eyes, but I personally still like using eye shields most of the time so that I can see what I'm doing. The eye shield in this isn't removable, and maybe there's a good reason, but I would prefer if it was, so that you could have the option of getting it closer to your eyes. But Light treatments do have effects on areas around the treated part as well, so it's not like it's completely excluding them. Flipping the shield out and taping it down solves the problem, but I don't know if this will stretch it out, and it just doesn't look as nice. In general, hard masks are more durable because there's just less stretching of wires, and there are exceptions, but this one just feels really solid so far. The cable also attaches magnetically, so there's just a lot less worry about damage if it gets caught on something. Also, just less wear and tear when you're plugging it in and unplugging it. Also, this means that this flexible wiring and battery, which are usually the first parts to malfunction, they can be replaced separately from the mask. Iristore also have a neck and chest mask. I don't have as much experience with these yet, but it has red and infrared with 230 LEDs in total. It has the same magnetic controller system. This has more coverage than the other popular ones, and I really like that the inside is matte rather than sticky. There's a 100-day guarantee if you don't see results, and if you use the code LabMuffin, you'll get $405 off the bundle. A lot of people have asked me about red light and hyperpigmentation, and this is a bit of a complicated topic. Mine has gotten lighter in the time I've been using red light masks, and there are studies where it evened our skin tone, including in darker skin. But some people have said that their pigment got darker, and I think that is a potential risk, but there are also ways to reduce that risk. It's a bit too complicated for this video, but I have an article on it, link is in the description. On to spicules, I have been asked so many times about what I think of the VT Riedel shot, so here it is. Spicules are a new trend mostly coming out of Korea. They are essentially microneedles that are inside the product. The ones you mostly see in products come from marine sponges. It's sort of like their skeletons. They are made of silica. This is part of the overall trend of delivery systems. These are like ways of getting ingredients into your skin better. So you'll see spicules mixed with lots of other ingredients that they should help get deeper into skin, but at the same time, they seem to have benefits of their own. So when you have these spikes and you rub them into your skin, they either exfoliate your skin and they get rid of some of the dead skin layers, or they might stick into your skin and create microchannels. These both mean that ingredients can potentially get deeper more easily. Spicules are relatively new, so there are essentially two big questions. Do they work and are they actually safe? In my opinion, it looks like they are effective for smoothing out skin texture and making pores look smaller. Those are the main things that people have been raving about, but it's a bit harder to say how well they'd work for delivering the ingredients deeper. Since they are physical spikes, that's going to depend on how you use it, so how hard you rub and for how long. Also, the specifics of the formula, so like the shapes of the spicules, how many there are, and what the other active ingredients are. There aren't a lot of human studies and they are all very small sample sizes, but overall, I think it's really promising. There is a research group in China led by Professor Ming Chen. They've looked at lots of really cool applications like delivering insulin and treating melanoma. These need to work much deeper than skincare, and generally the spicules are paired with other delivery systems like liposomes, but overall, lots of potential. The other big question is safety. So Dr. Dre in early 2024 said that she was worried about foreign body granulomas. Basically, the concern is sponge spicules are made of silica, which is the same as glass or sand. In theory, if a spicule gets too deep, you could end up with a chunk in your skin that your body can't break down. Your immune system might then react, and you essentially end up with a really angry bump that can be difficult to treat, and this sort of thing can take years to show up. Mo Skinlab is a toxicologist and cosmetic safety assessor. He did a great video going deeper into spicules, so watch that for more details. Basically, there's not that much solid data yet, and in theory, there is the possibility of foreign body granulomas, but there was a rat study that found that the spicules were shed by day 3. Obviously, rat skin isn't the same as human skin, and we won't really know with that much certainty until there are longer-term studies, which should hopefully be happening, especially if those Chinese researchers move towards drug approvals. But the risk does depend on pressure, so the harder you rub, the higher the risk. Uni Uni did an interview with someone from VT's product development team. They make the Riedel shot, which is the most famous line. They said their spicules don't reach the dermis no matter how hard you rub. Another interesting point I found in a recent paper, the Chinese researchers mentioned that their silica spicules are mesoporous. That means they are full of tiny holes, they have a different structure, so they should break down under lots of conditions, unlike more solid chunks of glass or sand. Now, we don't know if this is the case for spicules used in skincare or not, we don't know if their structure is different enough, but it isn't like all silica spicules are completely unable to be decomposed. It would be nice to see studies on specific products, but overall, it does seem like a pretty small risk, especially if you don't press very hard. Also, one of the studies was done using spicules made from hyaluronic acid, which is a lot easier for your body to break down, but I haven't come across products with those ones yet. Let me know if you've seen them. Also, the spicules seem to be too big to be inhaled if you were concerned about that. Onto vitamin C, I talked about L-ascorbic acid vitamin C formulas a while back, but there's been a few developments since then. The biggest one is that SkinCeutical CE Ferulic Patent, that has now expired. This is a big deal because Sheldon Pennell, who founded SkinCeuticals, he invented the most popular parameters for formulating L-ascorbic acid. Essentially, if you have a low pH and you combine it with particular antioxidants, it'll stay stable for longer and get into skin and work. L'Oreal acquired SkinCeuticals in 2005, so they own the patent, but now other companies can use this very proven combination. There's been copycats around for quite a while, but there was usually some kind of workaround to avoid patent infringement because, I mean, Drunk Elephant got sued for their formula. There were little differences, like some people who are more sensitive to vitamin C found that the SkinCeuticals formula was much less irritating, but now copycat formulas will probably be more similar and also more common, which is nice because SkinCeuticals was great, but pricey. But I also don't know if the patent expiring is that big of a deal anymore because in the last few years there's been a lot of different vitamin C products coming onto the market that I think are actually big improvements on the SkinCeuticals formula. And I mean, this is the whole reason patents expire. It's just meant to protect your invention for 20 years so that you can make money from it while also sharing it with the world and having that information publicly available so that everyone can benefit from that information and make more innovative formulas in the meantime. So newer formulas, first off, higher pH ascorbic acid formulas. I've talked about this a bit before, but a lot of skincare companies have been working on this for a while. Quite a lot of people find vitamin C serums irritating, and a large part of this seems to be that low pH. It is one of the lowest pH categories of skincare product. And in the last few years, L'Oreal in particular have launched a few higher pH L-ascorbic acid formulas. There was a bit of controversy on social media and on YouTube because some people were taking this one sentence from the Pennell vitamin C paper very, very literally. So they thought this was proof that anything higher than pH 3.5 could not possibly work. But peer review papers are written for an academic audience who know the background science of how ingredients get into skin, so in that context, it is pretty obvious that this claim only refers to very simple formulas. pH is only one of the many factors that influences what gets into skin, and there's been a bunch of papers and patients from brands, not just L'Oreal, showing that you can stabilize vitamin C and get it into skin at a higher pH. Disclaimer, I have done sponsored posts about this specific product, but I was approached to do that well after I first posted about this pH issue. Last time I talked about it, I was just guessing how it worked because I am terrible at finding patents, but L'Oreal did recently publish a paper. This has more details about the chemistry behind their approach, and I know I have a PhD in chemistry and this is my specialty area, but it is still nice to know that I'm right because imposter syndrome. It is indeed a polymer that binds to the ascorbate ion and keeps it stable, sort of like a chemical protecting group. During accelerated testing, it did go a bit yellow, but only about 6% of the ascorbic acid broke down, and these conditions are meant to reflect what might happen over a year at room temperature. They say they still need to work out if the polymer is holding the ascorbic acid on the surface of the skin and they're slowly releasing it, but L'Oreal have published clinical data on these formulas showing that they're working. I also wanted to give an update on POEMS from the lab Future Focus. This is the vitamin C formula from my friend Kind of Steven. He is a cosmetic chemist and his opinions on skincare science I really respect. So cosmetic chemists, they have very varied backgrounds and so sometimes the scientific reasoning is not the strongest. He has put a lot of work into this and I think it is a really nice demonstration that you do not need to be a giant multinational brand to make cool products. He stabilized this with a different antioxidant system from the SkinCeuticals patent, and those antioxidants do have benefits of their own. He's also using a different penetration enhancer, and this tube is super, super clever. It is really protective against air. There's this really persistent myth that airless pumps are protective against air, but they are really not. There are lots of little gaps between hard components. So gas molecules, if you think back to early high school, they are tiny and they are not bound to each other. So if you can see a gap, they can definitely get through it. Gas molecules are so tiny that they can actually get through some types of like solid plastic. I think I first talked about this in my wedding skincare video, but my first tube of this has now been open for over 18 months, which is more than a year and a half. I've kept it at room temperature, not in a fridge or anything, and there is brown stuff on the thread and also inside the cap. But it is still a really pale color. It is much less oxidized than newer formulas that I've tried. This is one of my top recommendations for a vitamin C serum. It is just really, really nice and it lasts so long. I know I keep saying I'm going to do proper videos going through retinol and vitamin C derivatives, and I swear I am trying and I'm working on it. I have about 30,000 words of notes on them, but the thing that's making it more difficult is how spotty the data is. A lot of the information on them comes from ingredient companies, and whether or not you can trust them is very much just based on vibes. It is much worse than peer-reviewed studies, and I've already talked about how hard it is to interpret peer-reviewed studies. I keep holding on to the hope that better data will come out and I can give a more confident, certain answer. If there's any brand who wants to share more info with me, please hit me up. But for now, I think it is pretty certain that vitamin C derivatives don't work as well as L-ascorbic acid, but they might be less irritating and more stable. My favorite vitamin C derivatives are 3-O-ethyl ascorbic acid, ascorbic glucoside, also THGA, but that is kind of like a wildcard pick where the certainty is like, there's just a lot of uncertainty. It could work really well or it could just not work at all. But if it does work, that would be really cool because it is oil soluble. If you want more about vitamin C, I have a video on that. You can also check out my video on why retinol is not a scam for more of the mess behind cosmetic science. Let me know what other innovative skincare products you're wondering about, and also check out my skincare science playlist.